So that's the scene here in New York, and still a few hours to go. It's going to be a long night, but it could be a great night here at Madison Square Garden.
Thank you, gentlemen. Much more from New York in the build-up. But before that, we concentrate on events in Manchester, where tonight we have three big title fights there, featuring men who could be on their way toward world title chances if they can keep winning. Let's join Jim Watt and first Rob McCaffrey there.
Paul, welcome to the Brawl for It All, as it's called, or Knocking Out Molars of Bowlers, which we quite liked. Heady days for Manchester sport, and in one, Michael Brodie, European Super Bantamweight champion. They've got a boxer they can be proud of. He's top of the bill tonight against the Frenchman Salim, Medjkoune, and Jim Watt. You're a big Michael Brodie fan, aren't you?
Yeah, definitely. Brodie is definitely the best super bantam in Europe at the moment. He's producing his best form of his career too, but he has to keep doing that if he wants to take the next step up to world class.
Well, Spencer Oliver once held Brodie's European crown a little earlier. He went backstage, he went to see him, he went to offer a little bit of advice, a little bit of help. Once great rivals, now great friends, the two of them. Delighted to say that Spencer Oliver is with us tonight, and Brodie can't afford any mistakes tonight, can he?
No, definitely not. You know, this guy's a worthy opponent. He's only lost one fight against Martin Krestev, and he's since knocked Krestev out in two rounds anyway, so it's a dangerous fight for him, and I think he's got to be on form to win the fight.
And he's a good one in front of his home fans.
Yeah, definitely. But I was speaking to him earlier on, he said all the preparation's gone well. He's sparring with Brian Carr, a good southpaw, and he said that everything's well, so I think we'll expect a good performance from him tonight.
We're looking forward to it. Jim and myself will be here right through to the big one, Lewis against Holyfield. We can't wait for that. As they say in New York, as they say here in Manchester, Paul, let's get it on.
That's a great idea. Delighted you could join us most of all. This is how the evening will pan out. Damien Kelly, the unbeaten flyweight hope from Belfast, will be first in the ring, bidding to add the British flyweight crown to his Commonwealth belt. He meets Anthony Hanna. Then, Brodie defending his European super bantamweight crown. We've caught a glimpse of him already. First defence for Brodie tonight against Salim Medjkoune, a former champion himself. Still in Manchester, Crawford Ashley, a big night for him, defending British, Commonwealth and European light heavyweight titles against Clinton Woods. Ashley still dreams of a third world title shot. So much more from Madison Square Garden then as we continue the build-up, but it will be Manchester first up, Barry, tonight. And Damaen Kelly, a young man who's been racing ahead, only eight professional appearances, but eight straight wins and already into championship class.
Incredible.
What about this job?
Incredible. I mean, the flyweights do reach their potential quicker than the heavier guys, but he had his Commonwealth title fight in his seventh fight and fought a guy who had beaten the former world champion, Svenika, from Zambia. Boxed his ears off, boxed brilliantly. Very talented young man, and if he plays his card right and doesn't get cut against Anthony Hanna tonight, he could go all the way towards a world title fight.
Kelly has left his dressing room. He's on the way to the arena there in Manchester. Our first title fight not far away. It's boxing's big night, and we start in Manchester with some of the best young talent anywhere in the country right now. First up, Damaen Kelly, already the Commonwealth flyweight champion, bidding to add the vacant British crown tonight. The man in the other corner is Anthony Hanna. Shouldn't be written out of this, a quickly improving fighter. Our commentary team there tonight, Jim Watt and Reg Guttridge, and first our master of ceremonies, Gary Logan.
And now, my man. Bowlers Nightclub in Manchester. Your next bout is the co-supporting contest of the evening. This bout is sanctioned by both the Commonwealth Boxing Council and the British Boxing Board of Control, and is live and exclusive only on Sky Sports. Your Commonwealth Boxing Council official tonight is Mr. Simon Block, and your stewards in charge are Alan Simpson and Dennis Lockton. Your timekeeper is Colin Roberts from Halifax, and your referee is star referee, Mickey Van. Ladies and gentlemen, 12 three-minute rounds for the vacant British Flyweight and Commonwealth Championships. Featuring in the blue corner, your challenger, wearing the blue trunks, fighting out of Birmingham, This gentleman weighed in at 7'13" and 1.5 pounds. This gentleman brings to the ring a record of 16 wins against 6 draws from 47 contests. He is the current Midland Flyweight Champion. Please welcome Anthony Hanna. And his opponent in the red corner. He is the Commonwealth Champion, ladies and gentlemen. Wearing the green and white trunks, fighting out of Belfast, Northern Ireland. This gentleman weighs in at 7'13". He brings into the ring an unbeaten record. 8 fights, 8 wins, 5 inside the distance. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the reigning Commonwealth Flyweight Champion, Damaen. Kelly. 12 3-minute rounds.
So a nippy referee here, this fellow Nicky Vans. Gotta be quick with these flyweights. Didn't bother him too much. He's already spoken to them in the dressing rooms and so forth. And well, Anthony Hanna in the blue there, 47 fights against this fellow Damaen Kelly. He's looked out there, who's won all 8. He's defending his Commonwealth Championship, and it's for the vacant British Flyweight Championship, vacated by A.D. Lewis, who's moved up in weight. So a bit of a test now for Kelly against a veteran who's actually only 24, believe it or not, but which happens to be a bit younger than Kelly. You would think with his entry into the pro game, so a bit late really, but brilliant amateur, boxed in the Atlanta Olympics, and was given a grant for the training for that one. And he won 2 bouts, and then of course that push button scoring, he lost the decision in the third. He's certainly been around a bit, Jim Anthony Hanna, isn't he, from the Nobby Nobs famous stable in the Birmingham area.
Yeah, well, some people would look at Hanna's record and say, what is he doing contesting the British and Commonwealth Flyweight title here, but he's far better than his record. And it also has to be said, he's been in with guys who are at least as good, if not better, than Damaen Kelly. I mean, he shared the ring with Paul Ingle, Paul Weir, world champion, and Jensen, the European champion, so he will not be out of his depth, and these two have met before, as you know.
He's won his last 6 fights, actually, Hanna. As you say, he's a bit short on the wins, but he's won his last 6. And fought Kelly to a points decision back in 97. That was only a 4-rounder anyway. Well, he has 4 wins and 2 draws, I think, that 6. He didn't win them all, but...
Yeah, I think that's right, Reg. I think it was 4 wins and 2 draws, but it's probably the best string of his career, and he's very experienced, really knows the game inside out. A real cagey little customer.
Well, one would assume the sort of final fling for him, really. Coming up for 50 fights soon, so he doesn't want to be around too long. Although we've got a few centurions in the British boxing at the moment, and one of them from his camp too, Peter Buckley.
Well, I tell you, a nice little competitive first round, Reg, yep. Been a lot of nice slipping and sliding from Hanna. Not a lot of effective work, but he's just thinking things out at the moment. I think the perpetual motion of Kelly could be a big problem, because this little fellow never stops working.
Okay. Well, just a bit of a reconnaissance round, really. Having a look at each other, and they've already fought 4 rounds. And the thing was that Kelly gets cut up a bit. I think that's going to be a problem. Let's have another look at it.
It's a good compact little fighter. You can sometimes worry about a boxer being Commonwealth champion after only 8 fights,
but he's a sort of little performer. He's 25 years old, Reg, so he's not a baby. But you worry about a kid getting ahead of himself. He's Commonwealth champion, so you have to be boxing at that level. But quite a little opening round, but some nice moves.
Wasn't an entirely Irish corner there, by the way. But his old trainer's with him. There's Nobby Nobbs, the infamous Nobby Nobbs, market trader in Birmingham, and actually loves the fight game. Second round. Scheduled, of course, 12 at the 8 stone, 112 pounds division. This division actually goes back a long way. The first British flyweight, I think, 1924, but before that, Sid Smith in 1911. Won what's called an Empire Championship then. Believe it or not, I actually met Mr. Smith a couple of times.
I think one little problem about Hanna, he leans forward a little bit from the waist. So his head is just that little bit further into punching range than you'd want it to be before he gets his own punches off. And the amount of punches Kelly throws, that might be a slight problem for him. Yeah. Tending to trade with Kelly, which I wouldn't recommend, not this early. I thought he would have spent the first couple of rounds pulling his tongue a little bit, just working some tricks on him, but he's standing his ground here.
A little bit of a chess match going on now, saying you lead to me and I'll counter. It's immense amateur experience, actually, of Kelly. I don't think there's anybody that compares with it in the ring today at any weight, really. 30 times he boxed for Ireland. Got a bronze in the World Championship in Finland and boxed in Atlanta in the Olympics.
Hanna trying to back him up now, which really is a good plan. If you can get Kelly on his back foot, you take away half of his, well, take away all of his momentum and probably half of his talents. But easier said than done. This little fellow is a little bulldog. He just keeps coming forward.
He's a very correct type of boxer, Damaen Kelly. Wants to make sure everything's delivered properly. So there's the countdown for the end of the second. So the moves are not exactly choreographed for them because they have been boxed a four rounder before. There's the lads there, Dean Powell from London and Mick Williamson and Michael Hawkins, who worked with Kelly when he was an Irish amateur. He's been with him a long time in the centre of the ring there. There you go now. Trying to bob and weave his way in there as he exchanges punches there, Kelly.
Yeah, two compact little fighters there. Kelly just pumping out the more punches. Two real competitive rounds to kick off. Kelly just that little bit busier, which is getting him in front. But certainly it's going to be a competitive little battle.
There's Peter Buckley, as I said, the over 100 fighters working in the corner with him. And there's Uncle Nobby. Third round then of this Commonwealth and British Flyweight Championship. Thank you. It's very early on to say it, Jim, but this could build into a stamina fight, this, you know, which one's going to stay most.
Well, I think that's Hanna's plan. I mean, he's obviously watched Kelly and he winning the title, and he just never stopped going forward, and they've obviously reckoned stand your ground and push him back, and that's what he's trying to do. He's having to take some jabs in the process, but he obviously reckons it's worth doing. Hanna is just refusing to take a backward step. They're just centering the ring, trying to force Kelly back. But he's really taken a few more than he wants to take. The idea's good, but as I said earlier, he seems to have his forehead just that little bit too far into range.
He's a very durable character, actually, Jim Hanna, because as I remember, he's only taken one count, and that was against Paul Ingle back in 94. Now Ingle challenging for a world championship.
Well, he's decided to do it the hard way, Reg. I thought he'd be trying the little tricks and trying to force Kelly into making mistakes, but he's not. He's wanting to push him back. Not an easy job, but he's doing not too badly at it.
He's tracking Kelly all right too, Hanna, isn't he? Trying to follow him around the ring, trying to cut off the movement a bit, moving on to the right hand perhaps.
See, the problem with Kelly, see, he's very compact, Reg, so even when he's been pushed back, his defence is always nice and tight, and he's pumping out the punches in threes and fours. And Hanna, he has the right idea, but he's just, as far as the points situation is, he's just taking too many of the leads, bang on the forehead.
Just a reminder that this is a special promotion on Sky Box Office tonight. If you have ordered this event and experience any trouble in seeing our pictures, this is the number to ring. It's 0990 800 860. That's 0990 800 860. Back to Manchester to rejoin Jim and Reg.
Well, a sparkly little fighter in this flyweights, you know. Believe it or not, they actually punched their weight as well, these eight stoners. There's a quick rundown of the punches thrown, and that's quite a lot of punches, 250 by Kelly. I thought Hanna fought quite well in that round as well. So it's Michael Hawkins is doing most of the talking, and the two London-based men just hanging in there in case they're needed. We're into the fourth round then. Just to re-identify Damaen Kelly, obviously the Irishman there in the green. And Anthony Hanna of Birmingham. 48th fight as a pro in this. Jim Watt's scorecard is he's lean there with Kelly for all three rounds. But really, there's not a lot in it. But it's because his volume of punches comes in from the Irishman, they've got to score.
See, that is the thing, Reg, that the scoring in a boxing match doesn't always reflect the action. I mean, Kelly could be winning every round just by a shade. You've got a real, you know, nip and tuck match, but there's a wide scoring at the end of it, and that's what's happening here. He's just always that little bit busier than Hanna. Hanna's committing himself, making the mistakes, and he's been made to pay for it. I just wonder if Hanna has the power to back up the tactics that he's adopting here. To stand in front of a man, you have to have the power to shake him up, and Hanna hasn't shown that yet. See, Hanna still refusing to back off, which again is the right thing to do, but he's just a little bit short, and the talent to turn it in his advantage. Kelly just a little bit sharp, but maybe they're looking to wear him down and get success in the second half of the fight.
They're both trying to tuck themselves in behind the glove, particularly Hanna, as you can see there. But Kelly's good defence fighter as well.
Yeah, well, he's just so compact. And although Hanna is coming forward all the time, he's not really pressurising him. Kelly is still, he's counter-punching, but he's counter-punching at his own pace. Hanna's stalking, keeps coming forward, but maybe a little bit more pressure.
Yeah, he's clearly winning this round, Jim.
Yeah, it's just sheer volume.
Yeah, absolutely. He's just been promising a bit, Hanna, but not unloading and producing.
See, there's that little left-right, just the old thing he's done 1,000 times as an amateur. And it's always paying dividends because Hanna's not moving his head. Kelly not getting too involved. He knows he's been cut before against this man. And,
so with that now, here's Rob McCaffrey having a word with the former champion, Spencer Oliver.
Tell you what, tight, tough, how do you see it at the moment?
Yeah, I think that Damien Kelly's just doing, you know, he's just beating Anthony Hanna to the punch at the moment, and I think that's the key factor in the fight here, that he's just quicker off the mark, and he looks like he's getting his shots in. That last round, he was getting his shots off a lot better, and he looks like he's just starting to climb on top.
Jim said the one thing Hanna's got to do is try and back him up a bit.
Yeah, he has. He is doing that. Hanna's, you know, marching forward, but he's not actually putting his shots together. He needs to start putting them together in threes and fours. At the moment, just going single shots, and it's not really working for him. Kelly's being allowed to hit him and move, hit him and move. So at the moment, he's still in a fight, but turning into a nice fight.
Kelly, at the moment for you, Spencer. Reggie, take it.
So there you are, words of wisdom. Round five, then. Vacant British Flyweight Championship up here, and a defence of the Commonwealth Championship by Kelly of Belfast. Yeah, he picks his punches off beautifully at times, Kelly, doesn't he? He's always got the right rhythm with them as well. And the variety of shots, you know, a little right hand over the top of the left lead, then the left hook. But Hanna's a spirited guy. This is where experience shows a little bit. He probably figures that he won't get another chance at a championship. And wants to give it all he's got. Fair dues.
I just wonder how young Hanna will be feeling about the 12 rounds, Reg, if he doesn't start achieving some success soon. I mean, we know he's never lacked heart, as you said. He's only been stopped once, but 12 rounds is a long time when things aren't going too well.
Well, he's only taken the one count, actually, Jim.
He's also been stopped. He's only been on the floor once, but he's also been stopped. But just that once. But as I say, 12 rounds, it's a long time if after the first 5 or 6 rounds you're losing heart. No signs of him yet, of course, losing heart. But not coming forward quite as strongly. Kelly's meeting him in the centre of the ring now and stepping in with his own punches. Few signs of damage as well showing up in Hanna's face. Really, it has taken a tremendous amount of punches. Not full-blooded shots, nothing to trouble him, but his face really reddened now.
Yeah, it's a very competent wearing down process. He throws so much leather, doesn't he, Kelly?
See, Kelly can work at a tremendous pace, and Hanna, as I said earlier, he's coming forward, but he's never pressurised Kelly. Kelly's always counter-punched and did everything at his own pace. And he is beginning really to enjoy himself, looking really solid and competent and quite happy in there.
This fellow looks like he keep it up forever with the speed that he works all the time. Very competent little performer. Meanwhile, backstage, Crawford Ashley's warming up there against Clinton Wood. There's the arrival. So it's a big night for him because he's a bit worried about doing the light heavyweight limit much longer. So he's got to see how he gets on with this one. So back to the action. Well, he's done this a few times before. As I said, this is his 48th professional fight. From a stable that jokes about itself, like Losers Unlimited and all that, but they're always fit and always willing to trade punches at the Nobby Nobs camp. Sixth round. And the defending Commonwealth champion, Damien Kelly, must be ahead. The sheer volume of punches and the accuracy. So there's Jim Watts, unofficial. As you can see, he's got Kelly well ahead there. But as he pointed out, there's not always a lot in the rounds, but nonetheless, Kelly sneaks them all the time. He had a clearer round, I thought, in the fifth round there. But not a two-point margin. You really need to score a knockdown and be overwhelming the opposition to get 2 points.
The big problem for Hanna, Reg, he's coming forward, he's doing a lot of things right, although they're not working too well. But he hasn't made an impression on Hanna. He hasn't even put a dent in the guy. So Hanna Kelly just working away at his own pace, quite happy. Adding up the points, any chance he gets, he moves forward with the punches. He's quite content to box on his back foot, which is unusual for him, but things are working so well for him. Showing actually good patience, Reg, considering it's only his ninth professional fight. Things are going his way. He could be forgiven maybe for trying to raise the pace and start pushing this fella back, but he's quite happy. It's a title fight. The main thing is the decision at the end, of course, and make sure the eyes don't cut in the early stages.
Such an energetic boxer, isn't he, Kelly? And in a way, the same goes for Hanna. He's a great survivor. He'll hang in there with everybody, give them all a bit of a problem. But he's just shipping a bit too much punishment in a way. They may not be powerful blows, but there's a lot of them coming in from Kelly.
See, in the previous meeting, over six rounds, Reg, then Kelly would have to start a bit quicker, get involved with Hanna, and that's probably why it was cut. But here we're over championship distance. He's improved since the fight, and he's got time to do the job properly, and that's exactly what he's doing. He hasn't put a foot wrong so far. Really controlled everything on his back foot, but always been in control of what's happening.
So let's go back to the studio and say, come in, Barry.
Yeah, Jim and Reggie, I obviously think that Kelly's doing very well. He's boxing sensibly, he's not exerting himself too much, he's moving around the ring and allowing Hanna to come on. Hanna has shown us what he's got. I don't think he has anything more except toughness and durability. And Kelly's just got to be sensible and careful and keep on doing what he's doing. Circle the centre of the ring, take control, and then start to sit down on his punches in a round or two. But he's got to be careful because he cuts so easily. But he's winning the fight by the proverbial mile at the moment.
Well, so far the scar tissue hasn't opened, and that's gratifying, really, because that could easily hamper a career. Round seven, then. Boxing, as they say, well within himself all the time, Kelly. I think he could stay forever against this, certainly against this type of opponent anyway. He wouldn't qualify to be one of the hardest punchers in the world at the eight stone division.
Give Hanna some credit too, Reg. He knows Kelly cuts easily. He's cut a couple of times already in his pro career. Things aren't working for him, but he hasn't tried anything nasty. I mean, it's been a totally sportsman's performance from both of them. No heads getting rubbed in, their elbows falling, punches. A nice clean little match. But I'm afraid Hanna's going to have to think up something. Hopefully it won't be that, but he's going to have to come up with something. It's really the fight is running away from him.
Yeah, the referee's enjoying himself. He's a spectator. He doesn't have to say anything, Mickey Van.
Kelly now and again just putting that extra bit of spite into the punches.
And incidentally, if it goes 12, then Van has got to make the decision. There are no judges. Pinches his punches perfectly, doesn't he there, Kelly? Really, it seems like he's enjoying every minute of it.
See, he's always poised to let the punches go. He's never in the wrong position. He's never off balance there. I mean, he's a small little fellow, obviously, but he's always so solid in his feet. I think he thought he felt a little bit of blood there. I saw him looking at his glove after wiping it on his eyebrow. But I think it's some sweat. Oh, no, it's not. He was right, Reg. It is blood.
Oh, yes. Oh dear, we were talking about that. I do hope that doesn't stop the contest. That'll spur Hanna on a bit though, Jim. He certainly spotted it.
Well, the good news, Reg, is he doesn't panic. He's already won fights with cuts. But a long time to go here, and just when Hanna needed something, he's produced it. I didn't see any clashes of heads, Reg, so I think we've got to see it was the punch that's caused it.
I still want to go to Brodie. That's what I thought.
Well, he hasn't totally gone in the tree. He's standing his ground.
Yeah, but he must be concerned, though. I'll tell you what, they'll dive in there with the coagulants as quick as they can. Mick Williamson's, there it goes, seconds. The moment he sits in the corner, that's got to be staunched right away. A pity in a young career like this, in only his ninth fight, he does tend to cut out like that. And I wonder if it was a head clash that caused it or not. Yeah, probably.
Well, that looked like a rub, Reg.
Yeah,
that would be the one. Yep, I didn't spot
could
that during the action. Don't you? Yeah, and that's where he's looking at it now.
Yeah, you spotted that well there, Jim. I missed that.
I saw him touching the eye, but the blood hadn't started. But as soon as that clash happened, he obviously knew, here we go again. You really have to worry whether or not everything's all right tonight. You have to worry about him for his further career. Although anybody will cut with a clash of heads. Anybody will cut.
Well, as boxing cuts go, Jim, it's quite minor, really. But
still bleeding, Reg. Still bleeding.
Yeah, it is. That surprises me. Mick Williamson usually stops them very quickly. Round eight. That's Jim's scorecard there is well up. And remember, under British rules, if the contest has to be stopped because of cuts, it does not go to the scorecards. The injured boxer loses. Yeah, he's going to try and use the ring a lot more now, Kelly. But the second's another chance to try and staunch that as it goes along. That doesn't repair it, but it'll certainly try and hold it up. It needs more adrenaline in there.
I mean, it's a pity. Kelly was showing total concentration in the first six rounds there. I mean, every move was bang on, perfect. Now, suddenly, something's happened to deflect that concentration a little bit. Now he's got something else to think about. So it might take him a round or so just to get his rhythm back again. But he's still pumping out the punches here. Yep, and still the more effective punches coming from the champion. Hanna not being able to capitalise on his good fortune.
Certainly got control of movement as well, Kelly.
See, I think if a round or two goes by and the cut hasn't worsened, then his confidence will go back again and he'll just get back into that routine. Although, it looks as though now he's got it back again. His mind is back on the job at hand. See, Hanna still trudging forward, but really achieving very, very little. Always beaten to the punch. Kelly always that little step ahead.
Another clear round for Kelly, Jim.
Yeah, Hanna's achieving nothing really, nothing.
Just a reminder, this is a special promotion on Sky Box Office. If you've ordered this event and you're experiencing any trouble seeing the pictures, the number to call is 0990 800 860. That's 0990 800 860. So much to come.
So they are working hard in that corner there. So there's Michael Brodie there warming up for defending his championship, the hero in Manchester, and a very good boxer indeed. So we're into round nine. Is it still a shutout, Jim, at the moment on your scorecard?
Yeah, definitely. Hanna, you know, his confidence level rose a little bit when he saw the blood, but he wasn't able to capitalise on it. He just kept coming forward, and I think he's feeling the pace a little bit himself, because none of his punches were a little, you know, kind of ineffectual in that round. He achieved nothing. But full credit, he's never stopped trying, Reg. He's never stopped coming forward, but Kelly's just that little bit too sharp all the way around.
Well, they've done a good job in the corner, Jim, haven't they? That's, as I said, it doesn't always worsen in a contest if you get some good corner men there, cut men. And it looks as though he may have successfully staunched it. Yeah, okay.
And the cut's always wet, Reg, right at the start of the round, so though it's not a bad cut, they don't seem to be able to stop the bleeding completely, so there might be a wee bit of depth in it, although it's not, as I say, not a long cut. But still Hanna walking onto that jab. Little, nothing fancy at the moment coming from Kelly. Just getting the job done, pumping out the little short straight punches.
Yeah, he doesn't miss too many though, Jim, does he, Kelly?
It might be time actually to stand his ground now and see if he can push Hanna back. Hanna is obviously feeling the pace a little bit. I mean, he's put out a lot of work tonight, really tried his heart out. So you're thinking, Kelly, he's a champion, we're looking to him for the future. It might be time, stand the ground and push the other guy back for a change. Sometimes when you're injured, it's a better plan to get the other fellow on his back foot, less chance of the injury worsening. See, we're seeing pressure from Hanna Reg, but not effective pressure. See, there's about five or six kind of arm punches and they all missed.
So here's Rob and Spence Oliver again.
Well, we thought the cut might change the complexion of the fight. It hasn't really proved that way, has it?
No, he stayed very cool. He showed, you know, great experience there. Stay cool, because it looked like it was going to be a problem. But he just stuck to his boxing, and he's giving an excellent boxing display now.
You could see Hannah's eyes light up, couldn't you, when he saw the clash of heads and the cut. But, I mean, Kelly, to That's be right. fair, he's boxed beautifully, hasn't he?
Yeah, it gave Hannah a little boost, but Kelly's just, like I say, stuck to his guns, and he's boxing beautifully. He's just quicker off the mark, and, you know, he's doing an excellent job out there.
Yeah, he's going to do it. No way back for Hanna now, do you think?
I don't think so. I think he's run out of ideas. He looks like he's run out of ideas now, and he's coming forward, and he looks like he's gone into that journeyman mode where he's just prodding forward and looking to survive. And Kelly's, you know, he's raised his game. He, like I say, kept cool after the cut, and he was top class.
Spence, thanks very much.
Well, that about sums it up. He and Jim want to agree on that, and I'll go along with it as well. But anything can happen in the fight game, and usually does. Round 10. But it would be a major upset now if Anthony Hanna of Birmingham could catch up with the Belfast man.
See, Hanna gets himself into punching positions, you know, every second of every round, but he doesn't let enough punches go. He moves into punching range, but he's the one taking the shots, and he doesn't have the power to upset Kelly. So it really, as Spencer was saying in between rounds, I really don't see the pattern changing. No signs that Kelly's going to force a stoppage, but it looks as if the pattern setting is going to continue. A lovely uppercut from Kelly there, neat little punch.
He's a durable character, Hanna, isn't he? Well, you don't have 40 fights until there have been a fight left in you if you've soaked up too much.
Yeah, I'm glad he got his chance tonight, Reg. I mean, before the fight, I didn't give him a great chance of success, but he fully deserved it. He's a great little pro. I mean, these guys are the backbone of the game. And he deserved it. His recent record is good, and he's one of these guys, looking at his record, doesn't tell you how good a fighter he is. He's a good, competent little fighter, just that little bit short when it comes to top level, and Kelly definitely is top level.
Not a change in the speed at all, Jim, isn't it? It's, you know, it's quite incredible where these fellas can go at the same pace the whole time. There's been no stealing rest at all, is there?
That's been the thing about Hanna. I mean, for effort he gets, you know, 100 out of 100, but he's never really pressured. He's stopped he's harried, he's pestered Kelly, if you like, but he's never really pressed, I've never forced him into making any mistakes. Kelly has always been comfortable at the pace he's been forced to work, so there's never been a dent in his armoury. Quality punches there from the champion too. Nice short, little accurate shots.
Just smudged around the eye again there, Kelly, but they're coping with it, and he is. Hannah, work that one out, Jim, there. The highs and lows of the fight game.
Yeah, that's the graph of the punches. As you can see, Hannah's never reached at any time the level of Kelly. Kelly, when the cut eye happened, his punch rate obviously dropped drastically while he got it into his mind, and then it just started to rise again, and that's what's been happening since.
Gives the impression he's in pain there, but he isn't really. He's just stretching the jaw there, Jim, isn't he? He's not worried about the cut.
Yep, oh no, he's all right now. The end of the tunnel is in sight. He'll be quite happy.
Seventh round then. So 6 minutes to go. And this little Belfast boy already, he's like a mechanical toy. You wind him up and send him out and it throws everything in flux. Flurries of punching, and Jim Watts has got him shut out at this stage of the game. As I said, no judges, referees, the sole arbiter.
It's actually heartbreaking, Reg. I mean, you feel you should be giving Hannah something for his contribution tonight. He's never stopped trying, never stopped coming forward, but really, he's been beaten to the punch all the way through. I'll be interested to see if Mickey Van also has a shutout. It'll certainly be one-sided. But at least the people that are here tonight know the effort young Hanna put up, so he can be proud of himself.
It's called from Hannah's corner there, saying, come on, let the punches go. And he is trying to trap Kelly there. This is sort of minor success he was having there, Jim.
Yeah, but I mean, he gets himself into punching position all the time, but he's got to let the shots go. But unfortunately, Reg, as we tumble fairly early in the contest, he doesn't have the power to back up the tactics that he's employed tonight. Just doesn't have the power to upset Kelly. So these are just arm punches, and he's weary as well now. Lovely uppercut from Kelly there. Yeah, this again. Cut, yes. Bleeding once,
yeah,
again.
Yeah, it is. It's reopened again. Oh, it's so accurate. It's like being in the gymnasium and practicing on a speedball gym, isn't it?
Yeah, I just think the biggest problem in Kelly's career is going to be the cuts. I know it was a clash of heads that caused the cut, and that can happen to anybody, but it's not the first. And I get the feeling it won't be the last one he suffers.
So the countdown, the end of the 11th. Some good defensive work as well by Kelly. So the final patch up in the corner, as you see on your split screen there, and he's having a problem around the right eye as well, and looking very tired, and just that red stretch there of the for the jabs landed by Kelly. And the referee reminding him, don't forget this is the last round. Have a look at that in replay.
See, and his defensive boxing, as well as his punching being so accurate, his defensive boxing, his evasive boxing, a treat to watch. Hanna actually smiled to the referee when they come over and they reminded him it was the last round. I mean, he, believe it or not, he's enjoyed himself. He can tell the grandkids he's contested two major titles.
Certainly blowing hard there he was, Hanna, as he left the corner. He's given him a nice little touch of encouragement. The referee's probably saying we're enjoying this fight. Keep it up, boys. There's some good boxing. I don't remember him calling break at any time, do you? He may have done, but I certainly don't remember it.
Well, no, it's probably been the easiest night Mickey Vann's had for a long time. And I say it again, full credit to Hanna. Things have never gone right, but he's never resorted to anything nasty, anything vindictive. No heads rubbing. I know it was an accidental clash that caused the cut, but some fighters in his position would have been rubbing heads in for the rest of the fight. He's done none of that. So full credit to the little kid. I hope he's been well paid tonight. He deserves it.
Yeah, Dobby Dodd's had so many good trial fighters around. He's actually only had one British champion. I think it was Lloyd Hibbert, wasn't it? Back in 87 was his only British champion.
But all of Nobby Nobbs's fighters learn the game, Reg.
Oh,
because
absolutely.
They never get easy matches, so they've got to learn how to look after themselves. And tonight, if this had not been a title fight, you would have seen a different Anthony Hanna. He would have been ducking and diving, dodging and weaving, just putting in a good night's performance, getting ready to box again this week. But this is a big fight for him. He's gone for the win, and well beaten. So people watching at home would not realise just what a good little boxer he is. This is not his normal type of fight.
Meanwhile, kind of yearning for that extra experience. The 12 rounds will do him good in terms of experience. Remember the amateur contest over three and occasionally four rounds these days, even five they're boxing, but he could do with a long distance fight now as he gets on with his career to get the ninth win into the last minute.
I suppose if you're looking for a question to ask Red, you might start seeing how much power is Kelly carrying. I mean, he's landed a tremendous amount of punches tonight, but he's never troubled Hanna in the slightest. Never really stopped him right in his tracks at any time. But having said that, Reg, we don't want to condemn or criticise a punch-perfect performance, and that's what we've seen from him tonight.
So get ready for the countdown. There can't be a knockout now, because the bell would interrupt. And there it is. Nice little friendly touch there at the finish. Hanna knows. Kelly knows. And it's come through another bit of a trial there with the cuts. It's the only real problem he had. He boxed quite brilliantly otherwise. So there's the total punches. I mean, just look at that, Jim. 1,085 against 800. I mean, he was sent. The flow was incredible at times, really. So the old doc having a look, saying, yes, report of my surgery tomorrow. No, I don't think so. Just maybe a couple of stitches by the look of it, that's all.
He's not ready yet. He's still speaking to
him. So, Here comes the scoring by Mickey Vann on the 10-point must system for each round.
Well, I don't think the message quite got through there, but the celebrations speak for themselves from Kelly. And to confirm, a convincing points win, a 38% success rate. He threw over 1,000 shots in that. And a pretty effective night's work from Kelly once more. Next up in Manchester, it'll be this young man, Michael Brodie. He has done nothing wrong in his career so far. 24 straight wins, a first defence tonight of the European Super Bantamweight crown. But the man in the other corner, Salim Medjkoune, is himself a former champion, and Brodie expects a very tough night's work. Later it'll be Madison Square Garden, on the night Lennox Lewis bids to become the undisputed world heavyweight champion. But next up, it's Brodie's turn in the spotlight. There was one scare for Damaen Kelly, surviving a cut again, but a ninth straight win, and the British flyweight title belt is around his waist now, added to the Commonwealth Championship. And he seems to take everything put in his path with comfort. Yeah. It's only his ninth professional fight
tonight.
Absolutely,
tremendous performance. He's an incredible kid. He can work at a phenomenal rate. He throws an enormous amount of punches. He could have done that all night and gone and run a marathon afterwards. Yeah. That's from a lifetime of commitment. And Mickey Hawkins done a brilliant job on him. Look at the punches here. 1,085 punches. 418 punches landed. And the headshot, 385. Now, there's an interesting point. 50, only 50 body punches. That's how cute this kid is and how well schooled he is by Mickey Hawkins. What he's done is he's concentrated all on head punches because he knows that if he bends to the body, he's likely to sustain more damage. And also what Jim Watt was saying, if he sits down on his punches and tries to punch at more power, he stands in punching range for longer and again can pick up damage. So that may affect his overall potential and his ability to punch with real authority.
Not doing much wrong so far though. And just to confirm for you, the points margin which we lost there was 118-110, i.e. very comfortable for him once more tonight. Later it's New York City. In the shadow of the Empire State Building, this is where the main drama will unfold. The first world heavyweight title fight to be held at Madison Square Garden since Riddick Bowe defeated Mike Doakes there in 1993. But the Garden is truly back as a big-time boxing venue. And tonight, maybe, Lennox Lewis will be inspired by the history of the great performances in this ring. It goes back the better part of a century. Some of the best of all boxing nights have been here. Lennox Lewis hopes that it will be his night. The day of destiny has dawned already for Lewis, and Adam Smith got privileged access to speak to him in his hotel suite a short time ago.
Well, Lennox, you look very relaxed here in your hotel suite with just hours to go. It's the biggest night of your life. What on earth is going through your mind?
Just very focused, still visualizing what I need to do in the ring, and just thinking about when I step into the ring.
Are you nervous?
No, quite confident.
What do you have to do from the opening bell?
Just go and assert myself and, it's a fight, so I'm just going to make it out to be one and just do everything that I've been practicing for 2.5 months.
Do you have to win it from the outside, behind your jab?
Yeah, I think that's a big key to this fight. And be a big man in the ring.
What if he gets inside you and starts roughing you up and he turns on the heat? What Lennox Lewis are we going to see then?
Well, I'm definitely, if he asks those kind of questions, I'm going to answer him with some uppercuts and some hooks and probably hold him or push him off.
Are you worried about any dirty tactics he might play?
It's nothing that clouds my mind, but I realize that he might try something, you know, with the head. But hopefully he won't be able to be successful with me.
What about this third round prediction?
I'm not even thinking about it, you know. My main goal is to go in there and win. For him to make those kind of predictions, realizing that I'm the toughest guy that he's ever fought, he must know something that nobody else knows.
What's your prediction?
That he will not knock me out in the third round.
And you will?
Be victorious at the end of the fight.
Do you think you'll stop him?
If an opportunity presents itself, I'll definitely take advantage of it.
Thousands and thousands of English fans have made the trip over. They're everywhere. How are they going to help?
They're going to give me some added support and strength.
And what's your message to everyone back home?
That, I'm in it to win it, and I'm going in there with the full mind of coming out with all three belts.
Is this your destiny?
Hopefully. Hopefully it is.
We wish you the very, very best of luck.
Thank you.
Suppose you call that keeping your powder dry. Glenn McCrory told us during the week that this is the worst time, when you have to wait, when even the weigh-in has been taken care of. But he looks supremely relaxed.
Yeah, I can't have Phil, and I'd like to see him a little bit more nervous. I know it's a mammoth occasion for him and everything else, and he's always been super cool. But I'd like to see him a little bit more apprehensive, because you know the thing that worries me is that maybe he's not afraid of Holyfield, and it's always good to be a little bit afraid of him. It helps you, keeps you on your guard, you know.
More later. Next, back to Manchester for the European Super Bantamweight title defence by Michael Brodie. Here's what happened at the weigh-in last night.
Exactly.
Brodie, we understand, was actually right on the 8-stone-10 limit.
8-stone-10-pound. Give an actual applause.
As our MC confirms there. And Salim Medjkoune, 8.9¼. Medjkoune is a pretty experienced warrior at this level now. And at world level, Barry, a very competitive division right now. We have the superb Eric Morales, great puncher, WBC champion. Vuyani Bungo, incidentally, has relinquished the IBF crown only this week. And Marco Antonio Barrera all lined up to fight Britain's Paul Lloyd. So Brodie can hope to get in there sooner rather than later, one would think. Incidentally, Brodie himself is ranked 3, 6, 4, and 3 by the four different governing bodies mentioned there.
Jack Trickett wants to give him every chance. He just doesn't want him to fight for it. He wants him to win it. So what he's doing is he's slowly allowing him time to mature and get better and develop.
Just to pick up on the point of maturity, you suggested to me during the week that maybe he started to get very big at the weight. Do you want to expand on that?
Yeah, I looked at him on the scales there. He's the biggest super bantamweight I think I've ever seen. He's absolutely crammed into the weight, and I wonder just how difficult it is for him to make it. He came in there right on the nose. He's been away in camp, staying in Jack Trickett's house and training away from home for 5 weeks, so I just wonder how much difficulty he has making the weight. He's huge for the weight. He's a terrific puncher. He's a very exciting television type fighter.
He's wonderful to watch, isn't he?
Absolutely brilliant to watch, but there is a chance that he may burn out because of the fact that he's trouble doing the weight and because he fights at such an intense pace. But it's a very tough division, Paul.
Let's hear from the former champion Spencer Oliver in Manchester with Rob McCaffrey.
Well, Spencer, I mean, you were in the dressing room beforehand. What's his mood, Michael Brodie, do you feel?
I think he's mentally tuned in right. Definitely, went in there, he told me he'd been sparring with a lot of southpaws, and he told me he's really up for the fight. So I think we're going to see, a top-class performance.
I won't say what his manager, Jack Trickett, said, because we get thrown off air, but he said he's been a nasty so-and-so this week. I mean, and he said that's not normal. That's how up he is for the fight.
Yeah, it's not normal, but it's a good thing. Yeah. When you start getting, I know myself, when I used to really get snappy 2 or 3 days before a fight, which means that he's up for the fight. And like I say, I think it's going to be a great fight anyway. The kid's no mug. He's only lost one fight in 31. But I think we're going to see the best of Michael Brodie tonight.
The fans all over the place. It's a great atmosphere here. Does that give him a lift? Or does that make him a little bit nervous in front of his own fans?
I think it'll give him a lift. Some fighters freeze. But I think, Michael Brodie boxing in front of his hometown, it'll give him a lift.
Thanks very much, Spencer. Back to you, Paul.
Short break coming, and then we'll be back to Manchester for our second big title fight of the night. See you in a moment. Well, is Michael Brodie going to the top of the world game? A European Super Bantamweight title defence for him now in front of his hometown crowd in Manchester. Here's Gary Logan.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome to the ring the European Super Bantamweight champion from Manchester, Michael Brodie! Oops.
terrific concentration though. He's looking up in the air. He's a very noisy fall, I must say. But he knows all about it, Michael Brodie. And McGregor may have a point there about whether he has to drag a bit to do the super bantamweight limit. That's 8 stone 10, 122. I don't think he does, apparently. He's got to believe the trainer and manager and so forth, and certainly manager Jackson has taken his time with this fella, but he's already champion at this weight. He's got a freedom of this French Algerian. It just might be a hard nut to crack, actually. So there's the tail of the tape and the rundown. Well, you know, he did it right on there, 8 stone 10. Nothing in the reach, and, well, the age of matter. It's very level, isn't it, in that? And again, Frenchman with 145 rounds against 122 gives him the edge of experience. But the knockout percentage is higher there for Brodie.
And now, five rounds on the Bowlers Night Club in Manchester. This is your main event of the evening. This is about this section by the European Boxing Union. Your presiding European Boxing Union official tonight is Mr. Peter Suki from Switzerland. Your judges for this contest are Paolo Scasso from Italy, Kurt Snow from Germany, and Jess Anderson from Denmark. Your timekeeper is Colin Roberts from Halifax, and your referee from Finland is Mr. Erki Mellerin. Ladies and gentlemen, live and exclusive on Sky Sport, Sky Box Office. 12 3-minute rounds of boxing for the European Super Bantamweight Championship. Introducing to you in the blue corner, your challenger wearing the black trunks with yellow trim, fighting out of Clermont-Ferrand in France, weighing in at 8 stone 9 and 1 quarter pound. This gentleman brings to the ring an impressive fight record. 28 wins, 15 inside the distance against only one defeat. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the former European Super Bantamweight Champion, Salim Medjkoune. And his opponent in the red corner, your champion, wearing the black and blue trunks, fighting out of Manchester. This gentleman weighs in on the championship limit of 8 stone 10 pounds. This gentleman brings in a formidable unbeaten record into the room, ladies and gentlemen. 24 wins, 15 coming inside the distance. Please welcome the former undefeated British super bantamweight and reigning European super bantamweight champion from Manchester, Michael Brodie. 12 3-minute rounds of boxing.
So that's the Finnish referee. Saw him box a lot as an amateur. Very skillful amateur boxer indeed, Eric Mandelon. Well, it'd be interesting to see which Brodie's turned up for this one, because a couple of fights he's just, I don't know, a bit short of the peak that we expected from him, and then another time he'll look brilliant. So I think he may have to do it with this fella. Only one loss and a former champion at this weight. Defeated the Italian Bel Castro with cuts, actually, and there was a riot afterwards. The referee had to rush out the ring, Paul Thomas. So now the southpaw apparently got a hard chin, although he has been knocked over. Against 24 fights on the turn now, 15 stopped or KO'd by Brodie. Wonder how the ordinary style of Brodie, the, you know, good correct type of boxer against the southpaw stance, will work out. He's obviously worked in the gym with some right hand forward boxers, or has got previous experience, including in the amateurs, having a brief fight against Nazim Hamid.
Well, Medjkoune looks like one of these wide stance spidery upward southpaws. So Brodie's concentration is going to have to be a little bit sharper. He's sleeping a little bit in the first minute of the fight here. He just wants to think a bit sharper. This fellow is certainly going to be awkward. I don't know how powerful he is, but he's got that awkward look about him already.
Well, his record, he's travelled pretty well. I saw him fight Peter Buckley in London. Well, Buckley can duck and dive cleverly against anybody, so it was a difficult one to judge him.
It doesn't look to me this early leg like the kind of southpaw that you want to counter punch. You want to get your shots off quicker. He's awkward, he's long armed, and he swings them from queer angles. So Brodie wants to get the shots off first, not try to counter-punch this fellow.
Some good solid shots going in on the first round, aren't they? Not hanging about.
I don't know, Reg, if it's because they're black, but they look like real solid little punchers boxing gloves they're using tonight.
Yeah, they do, don't they? Well, Brodie knows now. This fella's going to be a bit, not only awkward, Jim, but a bit dangerous as well. So he's unloading some punches now.
And there was the first head clash coming from the challenger. Brodie's going to have to be careful with this fellow. Thankfully, he's warming up a little bit in the last half minute, but Brodie took too long to get started in the first round there. He wants to get his concentration together a little bit quicker.
Foster in the corner there, and the manager Jack Cricket on the outside is sweating a little bit, as he always does. So let's have another look at this now in replay. See, that one is a bit of a wild swing, and luckily he was almost going away from it there, Brodie, but he could afford to do without that.
And you might notice, Reg, with the punch, the head beat the punch in. The head was on Brodie's chest as the punch was being launched. This fellow's going to be dangerous with his head. Brodie is going to have to be thinking sharply here, get his punches off quickly.
Style-wise, you see, he's the chairman of the Who Needs Him Club, I should think.
Well, when you see the legs spread wide and the long kind of spidery arms, you know you're in for an awkward night.
Second round in the European Super Bantamweight Championship. 58 kilos. Michael Brodie from Manchester, 24, 3 years younger than the challenger from France, of suspect North African descent. Been in some hard matches on Medjkoune. He fought the Bulgarian Crusted, as we've seen a lot of, and was knocked over, but got his revenge in 98 by winning.
Brodie wants to get his feet up a little bit closer to this guy before he lets the punches go. He's reaching a little bit with his wide punches. He's using up steam that he doesn't have to. He just wants to get his feet a little bit closer and shorten the punches to keep his chin down. This fella is going to be awkward.
Yeah, spidery was your description. It's a good description, Jim. He really is like a flailing octopus. European Championships, a lot of standing in America, much more actually than the British Championships.
That's a good right hand, that's the one.
Yeah, that's the counter, that's the stop counter, isn't it, for the southpaw. He kind of relishes in a battle, actually, Brodie. A wonderful fight he had with the Welshman Neil Swain and Withenshaw.
Brodie's just getting a little bit involved, Reg. This is the type of opponent, a little feint works wonders. Show him a little feint, get him to make the first move. Just a stumble. just a stumble.
I thought he was going to give him a count, actually, because there was a punch as well involved.
I think Medjkoune looked at the referee hoping for the best there, but that was only a stumble.
Yeah, that was the stance, the right foot forward that got him at it there, but he almost tripped over that, Brodie.
Brodie's punches are too long, Reg. He's got to get close and shorten them. This fella's difficult. That was better. Just get close and shorten the punches. These big long punches are missing.
This is going to be a hard battle, Jim.
That's better from Brodie. Use his feet in and out. Yeah, a nice little uppercut, so a good shot.
Good armour he's got. He can switch any type of punch, actually, Brodie. He's a good boxer.
See, that's what he wants. Nice and close, Reg. Nice and close and shorten the punches.
He learns quickly, actually. This is fighting better than he did in his previous fight, Brodie, with Brian Carr.
See, that was more of a kind of push. He seemed to glance at the referee, hoping for a count there. But no such luck. That was never a knockdown.
There's the punches statistics, then. As you can see, Brodie did throw more punches in that round and landed more. Not a lot, though. Yeah, the fight total. He's certainly got a bit of an extra growth on the old beard there to protect the face. It won't stop the force of the punches, but it might stop a few chafing blows going past. Third round. Rhythmic chant for the Michael Brodie chant. Sort of a soccer style song there going in.
Medjkoune switching to orthodox there for the second time. Everything awkward, he can do it. See, Brodie's kind of reaching with that jab. He needs to get his feet a little bit closer, as I say, and get the shorten the punches. Short, sharp punches. Everything nice and tight.
Finish referee reminding him to keep the punches up too there, the Frenchman.
Lovely right hand lead from Brodie. That's what he wants, hands up and just shorten the shots. Lovely.
Dying to time a sort of counter punch here, Brodie. He's waiting for the Frenchman to sort of lunge at him, and he'll put him with a right hand shot, I think. He's a bit of a battler, though, isn't he, Medjkoune? He really is. He's enjoying it, and it looks like he doesn't mind fighting the other fella's backyard either.
During the introductions, Reg, we were saying to each other he's got that kind of rough look about him. And that's proved to be the case. Not a lot of class in what he's doing, but a hard night's work for anybody.
He backed off from that body blow there, Medjkoune. It was a really good solid whack to the ribs there by Brodie.
Bit more rhythm in what Brodie's doing now.
Way they're exchanging punches here, you're wondering whether this could possibly go the distance. I would doubt it.
It's a tremendous pace, Reg. They're both expending a lot of energy. I think Brodie's punching just slightly higher quality in this round, which is maybe just nicking it in his favour, but not a lot of difference in punches landed. Just a wee bit better quality from Brodie.
satisfactory round, I would have thought, that one for Brodie. Well, two for the price of one there with your pictures. Now, there's very little in that, really, isn't there? If you're looking at the colour spread, anyway. But it's what the judges think about, whether the quality of the blows, which one has the better quality, that should come into it when they're so close and the punch is landed. And he won that vacant championship, like I said, back with Neil Swain and Willenshaw, and then won a belt. And first wages he got in the pro game. Yeah, his mother died at 15, and the first thing he did was to pay for a new gravestone for him. So, you know, these lovely rags to riches stories that you get so many of them in boxing, and certainly Brodie comes into that category. Forgot to put the gun through it. Oh dear, I went tonight in Dixie, that one. Round four.
That was lovely, just a little step back from Brodie there, then step back in again with a little three punch burst. Nice.
There's your card, Jim, there. She says it's close, this. It's going to stay close until the one that lands the harder punches. I tell you what, when it comes to grip teeth time, Brodie's good at that.
Yeah, he's developing that little bit of confidence in his work now that was maybe missing a couple of times. Boy, I think he's a little bit angry here, Reg.
Yeah, he is. He's got the hump, as they say. He's certainly doing well there.
He's got the hump, as you say. He's having the last word, and this early, that's good news. In these exchanges, he's having the last word.
They've obviously sent him off the stool to say, hey, now you've got to stop this fellow in his tracks. Don't give him any headway if you can help it.
Yeah, well, I feel you don't want to be reaching punches at this fellow. You want to get on top of him and shorten the punches, and that's what he's doing here. Get the feet closer, get the chin down, because this fellow's head's dangerous, and get short, stiff punches out.
Oh, that was a good shot, that, Jim. That right hook, he turned southpaw on it, Brodie, there. And that one, the repeat punch.
Because Brodie can throw them short, he's far more effective up close with this fella. Yeah. It's hard work. I mean, it's tough going, but his punches are more effective.
Well, fair enough, it was a bit low, but he didn't really protest too much, but can give him credit for that. Some battle, isn't it?
This is good stuff from Brodie in this round. This is his most impressive work so far. He really looks as though he fancies the job. Nice little step round, that's lovely. Now that's thinking, that's what you want to see. You want to see somebody trying things you didn't see them do in the last fight. This has been a real good round for Brodie.
Some good quality boxing and punching power, but in fairness, both of them, and especially by Brodie.
Yeah, it's the mobility, the way he stepped to the side, made himself some punching, and there he's doing it again. Now you can see he's working on things in the gym. See a bit of blood coming from the top of Medjkoune's head. Can't be serious, but there's a trickle of blood coming down.
Well, there you go. Here's Rob and Spencer Oliver once more with an opinion.
Do you know what? Start of that last round, Michael Brodie looks over to your man here, and you said what to him?
I told him to start letting his punches flow a lot more, stop loading up, let them go in threes and fours. And he had a much better round there. When he started putting them together, he had a much better round, and that's what he's got to do.
And the thing was, he had a little chance to look at us because there was a little break before
and he
took it on board, didn't
that's
he?
That's right,
information.
Yeah, he started letting them go, and it was working for him a lot more. It was the best round of the fight that he's had so far, and to win this fight, that's what he's got to do.
At the same time, Medjkoune is throwing punches from so awkward angles, isn't
he? Well, he's a southpaw, and it's hard to fight southpaws anyway, and he is awkward, like you say, and he sort of wins. I mean, he's a strong man. We always knew it was going to be a tough fight.
That was a good round for him.
Yeah,
that was better, wasn't it?
It was the best round so far.
Spencer, thanks a lot.
Well, Nick come out for this round. Medjkoune does have a cut high on the head. He must haul him off the stool there. That's not really, he wasn't that tired. That must have been when they were just banging heads close in there. It's a long way from the danger area. And five. And there's Jim Watt's scorecard with Brodie ahead.
Well, second and third rounds are fairly close, Reg. But that was different class Brodie in the last round there.
Well, we worry about judges, who they are and what we think they may be doing closer to the end of the contest. If it does need a judges here, I'm beginning to wonder.
Yep, the accurate shots again were from Brodie there. He was blocking the shots coming his way and getting his on in target.
He actually relishes having an opponent like this. The hit and run clever guys is not for Brodie. He likes them to come at him and swap punches. And he does have a lot of quality in his work, Jim, doesn't he? He's an accomplished boxer.
And I like his attitude tonight, Reg. I think in some performances with Brodie, you get the feeling he's feeling sorry for himself when things are going rough. But tonight, he's like a man in there now, as though he believes in himself and he really fancies the job. It's all coming together for him at the right time.
So far, Franklin's absorbing those punches pretty well, and they're catching him flush too.
And Brodie's blocking most of what's coming back. Nothing really cleanly on target coming back. I can see what Barry McGuigan means when he's saying he's the biggest super bantamweight he's ever seen. I mean, what is he like here? You can see the sheer look of strength and power about his work.
Very diligent trainer, as I'm told. Brodie, manager Jack Triggett, doesn't have any trouble with him, or Ray Farrell's new trainer, or relatively new trainer.
Well, Medjkoune wasn't a stylist to begin with, Reg, but under this pressure, his work's becoming very ragged. I mean, this is hard stuff for Brodie, but he's definitely, the quality is coming from him at the moment.
Referee tries not to interfere there to call him break. He's does step between them occasionally, but he's letting them get on with it. Well, I see where they're working on the top of the head there somewhere. Yeah, there it is. Oh, it's way out of danger. There you are. Can't get any closer than that. Hard game, isn't it, this? Let's have a look at it again, Chip.
Well, you can see Mishkun's what really becoming ragged now. But the accurate stuff coming from the defending champion. Took a little cuff back there, but the stuff he dished out was far better. Look at the way he's just stepping back from the punches. Never too far out of range, always ready to step back in again. Really boxing well at the moment, Michael Brodie.
Punches landed. Well, it says it all, really. That was a very good round indeed there for Brodie. But the body language of Brodie, Jim, tells you that he does enjoy what he's doing as well. Obviously, you know, defending a championship. He just enjoys being in there. That people that haven't had that experience of being in a ring and being in command like that, don't know, any of you guys that have been champions understand that, Jim.
It's funny, now that young Spencer Oliver mentioned, I can see him at the beginning of every round, he's looking down at Spencer. This is always putting this show on for Spencer here. I mean, these are two guys who could have been boxing each other. But it really looks as though he's putting on a special show for Spencer Oliver. He's certainly fired up for it.
Yeah, he's going to harass the daylights out of him now, Brodie. See this, he'll track him all the way around.
Well, these awkward guys, you've got to get them under pressure, under control, and that's what Brodie's doing. He's not reacting to what Medjkoune's doing, he's setting off himself, initiating the action, and it's working fine.
He says very little, this Finnish referee. It, as I said, was a very good amateur boxer anyway, but he just shows the signs of what they're doing wrong to them so that they can't misinterpret the words.
Medjkoune slipped into a kind of survival type mode at the moment. I don't mean he's giving up, but he doesn't seem quite to know how to nudge a slip. I don't think he knows how to cope.
A low punch. Time, take time off. He wants to give him, wants to give him a breather.
He's saying that Medjkoune's shaking his head. I don't see that at all, Medj. Maybe we'll see it in replay. I mean, Medjkoune didn't complain. He shook his head. No, nothing wrong.
Right.
Don't know about that one. He really looks firmly in the driver's seat at the moment. He's not really getting home with too many great punches in this round, Brodie, but that's because Medjkoune is totally in survival mode.
Love the way Brodie puts on the pressure. You know, that's the mark of a champion, isn't it? Sort out the champs and the chumps, really.
So I see Brodie taking a little half step in, back out again, then back in again, really mixing this guy up. He's looking like a real pro tonight. Medjkoune just standing his ground here, showing a bit of danger.
Good, exciting contest this. And I must say, I've always fancied Brodie being a bit of a star, and he's starting to look it tonight.
Yeah, it's just the attitude that's impressed me so much tonight. Total belief in himself, because this fella, make no mistake, Reg, this is a rough fellow and he's awkward.
So back to the studio and come in Barry again.
Yeah, Reggie, he's doing an excellent job here. The word that Jim used there, and just to reiterate what he said he's maturing tremendously, young Michael Brodie. He really is. This is an excellent performance against an awkward, tough guy. And he's produced some great work. He's getting closer to the guy. He now has him worked out. What he's got to do is just got to punch chest high, nice little knee combinations, and try that right hand. Here's the look at this controversial knockdown here. We think it was a punch. Well, like a bit of both, really. He did hit him below the belt, and there's no doubt about that. So he was warned. The referee done a good job, so he was closer to the action than we were. He's doing a good job, just got to keep it up. And the guy's beginning to tire a bit, just got to keep on top. Maybe he'll stop him later on, who knows.
Yeah, well, the referee was dead right there, Barry. It was a low punch.
Yep, letter of apology from me.
Yeah, well, he had his back to us, Jim, right about.
That was
one of them. We saw it better in the pictures than we did in the flesh. Well, he's fighting well enough here. He's not interfered with the family jewels.
Never seen Brodie so mobile, Reg. He's moving around the ring so well, using his feet, you know, to into range, out of range. It's nice to see he's really improving. Medjkoune trying to stop the rot here, get himself back into the fight.
And enjoy himself trying to fight like that inside. Medjkoune is the one that's going to take most pain. Oh, it's good practice, isn't it? No interference at all from the referee here, and if they keep the punches up like that, it's going to go on forever.
Well, a little test here of Brodie's character, Reg, because he's put out a lot of good work, and here's the guy coming back at him. The best spell for Medjkoune since the first round. So this is what Brodie has to say. I've done the job. Now I'll have to start and do it all over again. He's coming back at me.
Well, Jim, when you reach this, you know, European level, you've got to reckon most fights are going to be tough. And Brodie has accepted that anyway. I don't think he wants it any other way.
No, he's still got that confident look about himself. He stood with the guy. He's taken his best and he's forcing him back again. Can't ask for more than that.
Oh, beautiful championship locked in that. Picked his punches perfectly there, Brodie. Takes the occasional punch as he walks in, Jim. But this fella, well, he's very unorthodox, isn't he?
This is a tough round, Reg. This is the round that could decide what takes place from now on in. Because Medjkoune got himself back into it in the first couple of minutes. Brodie's answered that we have just as good. A fairly level round, but this could be the round that just sees which one takes over.
Just imposes his will on the other guy, Brodie, doesn't he? He stands there and saying, okay, if that's who you've got, I've got to do something better. Very impressive, and I tell you, you don't write this fellow up, the French Algerian or North African, whatever he is. He's a hard old nut. And, well, even if he has got a slight cut in it. Very impressive, and I tell you, you don't write this fellow up, the French Algerian or North African, whatever he is. He's a hard old nut. And, well, even if he has got a slight cut in it. Punches landed. Look at that, you see. It's a spread by Brodie, isn't it? 194 to 133. That's not bad at all.
I've got Brodie in front, Reg, but Medjkoune certainly come back at him in that round. That was a tough round. So, this is the big question now. Brodie come back towards the end of the round with good stuff, but a lot of the early running in that round came from the challenger.
He tucks himself well in there with his hands held high, Brodie, and then he unleashes the punches.
That's again where he uses his feet so well.
Yeah, he
just slips to the side, back in again. Nice bit of technique there.
Round eight. Of the scheduled 12 for the European Super Bantamweight Championship, defending champion Michael Brodie and the French Algerian Medjkoune, 27, and Brodie's 24, and Brodie's also 24 unbeaten fights.
Nice sound defence, he's boxing behind as well, Brodie. I mean, this is a tough fight, Reg, make no mistake about that. This guy's a handful. Brodie just looking for a little breather for the first time. Happy to let it go at long range, maybe thinking come in the last minute or so.
Just jumping ahead, if it does go 12, we've got judges from Italy, Germany and Denmark. Referee from Finland doesn't vote.
Oh, nice turn from Brodie.
Beautiful the way he spun him around there.
Surprises the no cut shoot, Reg. Their heads have been banging together.
Oh, he's working the body well there, Brodie. That could bring the Medjkoune's hands down quickly.
Definitely, he always has that little look of quality. Even when punches landed, not a lot to choose between them. Brodie's work always looks that bit more refined.
Tough division, actually, at world level. This one, we've got three Mexican various association champions.
And again, some nice evasive boxing from Brodie. Quality punching.
Even when he was trapped in the corner there, he was working his way out cleverly by countering and turning. Well, good gone. Shot. Waddle. I don't know what he was going to do there, the referee. He got a free shot at him there, Brodie. He didn't hold her. He has to continue to count despite the bell having gone, and then he can get up. He could have counted him out, remember, if he hadn't got up on time there, because the bell does not interfere on the knockdown. Well, now that took Brodie a two-pointer ahead on that round now. And, will he finish it? Brilliantly done. Have a look again.
Yep, lovely puncher. I mean, his body punching all through his career has been excellent. Bang, two beauties. And he took a little breather at the start of the round, which was a good idea. Finished it so strongly, ends up with a two-point round. Just exactly what he needs to get the latter stages right in the right direction. And comfortable ahead in points now. And Macard, there's still a bit of work ahead of him. Lovely punch. Just took everything away. Tried to survive it, then the second shot came in. He went down there just for safety.
Round nine. Now, is he going to just bide his time a bit here, you know, with a hunter's patience or not? I don't think Brodie will. He'll go for it.
It's sometimes a good idea after a good body shot to get on top of the man while the punch is still on his mind. Yep, see, this is what's happening here.
And he stopped it in the ninth round. Brodie was a bit surprised, actually, the way he reacted to that. It was a great win. A great finish. Probably the best night's work we've seen from Michael Brodie, Jim. You agree?
The most mature performance I've ever seen from him. He fancies his job right from the start. He looked like a man in there. I've seen him sometimes boxing there, but looking like a young kid learning the game. Tonight he looked like a real professional, a real mature man. Excellent performance. Best I've seen from him. First class, and that is a good opponent, Reg. He has stopped tonight.
Well, joining in the celebrations there would be the manager, Jack Trickett, as well, from outside the ring, and he's now in, as we watch this final punches coming in again. Different angle.
See, after a good shot, a good body shot, Reg, it's a good idea to get on his top straight away while he's still thinking about the punch, and that's what happened. I mean, nothing really happened to Medjkoune here. He just lost heart. The referee, really, there was no great reason to stop it, but I think Medjkoune just didn't fancy the job quite as much. I think that body shot in the previous round took everything away from him. Brodie got right on top of him, didn't really land a finishing punch. That punch didn't land. No, he was looking for the body. That was just a stumble, really. No reason for the referee to stop it, apart from the fact that he reckoned Medjkoune had lost desire.
Little by little, this word spreads again about Michael Brodie, way beyond Manchester, maybe even into world class, but for now, a reigning European super bantamweight champion. More on his performance in a moment. And next up in Manchester, it's a big night for Crawford Ashley. All his three titles are on the line at light heavyweight. Clinton Woods is the man coming out of the other dressing room shortly. Ashley must win for his world title ambitions to be fulfilled. Authoritative display from Michael Brodie tonight. Round eight, turning point. Salim Medjkoune down. Superb body punching from Brodie. And like the good professional he's becoming, finishing the job when the chance presented itself in the following round. Brodie, 25 straight wins, still European super bantamweight champion. And here he is with Rob McCaffrey.
I don't even hear me under the... You must have, first of all, the cheering for you tonight was terrific, wasn't the support you got?
My fans in Manchester are brilliant. They follow me everywhere. All the lads from the Fountain in the grey mare. Miles playing, look at him. Can't and go Salford, wrong. He loves me.
Yeah, look at that. Swinging over there, the boys giving
look
it a
look. Look at them all. They love me.
Tell me about the fight, first of all. You took maybe a couple of rounds to get warmed up, do you feel?
I was seeing what he was like, because he's a southpaw. I was looking at him and that. And I knew it after three rounds of him, I knew he was going to take him apart. Yeah.
Barry, you suggested to me that it was all going to fall into place and that Medjkoune was falling apart.
Yeah. That was the most complete performance I've ever seen from the kid. He's getting better all the time. And I'm telling you, the way he's going, there aren't many super bantamweights out there that's going to be able to handle this. He's huge for the weight. Team in an interview, the massive guy. He uses his strength perfectly. His body punches were great. His, no combinations. Nobody's infallible, but he had been guilty of making mistakes in the past. The defence was a little bit leaky. Tonight, he was complete. He was really tight. Combinations were great. Finishing was spectacular. This kid's going all the way.
Thank you, Barry. Let's get a word with Spencer Oliver, the former champion at this weight, of course, talking to Rob McCaffrey.
It really is the long and the short of it, isn't it, this one here? But you were talking through him throughout the fight there, Michael Brodie. He kept looking at the start of the round and you were so impressed, basically.
Yeah, no, I thought, you know, he's improving all the time and, you know, he showed a lot of maturity in that fight and, you know, he proved that he can box as well as fight and he dug deep as well. He was a tough opponent he had there.
Tricky, wasn't it?
Yeah, he really was and I think he proved there that he's world class.
You were shouting to him, though, shorten your punches, which I think Jim Watt was reiterating
yeah, that's right.
as well.
Well, he was getting in tight and he was just loading up with a single shot, so he should have been working threes and fours, which he'd done, and he looked much more impressive.
You've known him for a long while. You've seen him getting better. How good can he be, do you feel?
I think he can go on and win a world title as long as he steered the right way. You know, I think another couple of defences of the European and then bring him onto the world team, without a doubt. He's improving all the time.
As long as you're in the corner, that's what you want.
Yeah, that's
as long
right.
as you can see
that's
for the right. first round.
Yeah, no, I just felt that, you know, given that he was loading up all the time on the shots, and as soon as he started putting them together, he was a different class.
We're delighted. They're all delighted, believe me. Great performance tonight.
Thanks, gentlemen. Back to Manchester shortly, but high time perhaps that we heard from the man in the other corner in our top of the bill tonight. Lennox Lewis, serene and composed on the day of the big fight. Earlier in the week, Ian Dark got the chance to put one or two points to the astonishing Evander Holyfield.
Evander, after everything you've done in boxing, all the great fights you've been in, what's your motivation to go on and beat Lennox Lewis this Saturday?
Well, there's a lot of love in this game for me. It's not a selfish type thing, it's a passion. It's something that I've been anointed to do, and something that's pretty much going to prepare my life further than what boxing would take me.
Your place in history is already secure, so what makes you go on?
Well, if I'm going to be in something, I might as well take it to the end. It would be wrong for me to get out of a game of boxing and leave it staggering to who the best. If I would have got out of boxing now, people would still been arguing who the best in the nation. Then nobody fight Lennox Lewis. But because I chose to do the right thing, no one would ever have to worry about who was the best in that era. They would know that Evander Holyfield was the best because he fought all the people that was in his era.
Tell us what your prediction is, because it's unlike you to make predictions. You've done it for this fight.
Well, I'm not predicting, I'm just telling the people the truth. I'm foretelling people what's going to happen on the 13th. Now, on the 13th, I'm going to pick up the belts, but I'm going to, the process of getting the belts, he's just not going to hand the belts over, so I will have to take the belts, but I will have to knock him out to take the belts because the man too big for me to just wrestle with him, so I have to knock him out.
You're saying a specific round, round three?
Yeah, three.
You're absolutely rock solid certain of that, are you?
Well, you would know on the 13 as well.
So is that reverse psychology or is this a new Evander Holyfield? Did you come up with yet another plan to astonish the world of boxing? And yes, hasn't he done it often enough before? Julius Francis has joined us, long-time Lewis training partner and reigning British champion. Excellent to have you with us for the rest of the show. Evander Holyfield, how did you view what he was saying there?
Well, I believe he's talking himself, or trying to talk himself, up into this fight. It's kind of strange him start predicting this kind
What's
of
What's your view on that?
I just think it's very different. I think he's trying to psych Lewis out, but
no,
I don't think it's going to work.
I'll tell you, it's a clever bit of trickology. That's what he's doing. He's trying to get him to sit back and to wait for Lewis or for Holyfield to come at him, Julius. That's my my way of anticipating this. And what he's doing is, Lewis is going to be guarded. He's going to hope a couple of rounds go by, and then he's going to get into the fight.
I don't see it.
That's what I think he's doing, because he knows Lewis is an incredible starter, and he wants to back him up and keep him thinking. That's what he wants. And well, he's a slow starter.
If Holyfield takes the fight to Lewis, Lewis is only going to be there. He's going to be too big, too strong, like I've been saying. And that's going to be his downfall.
That sets up the argument for a little later on. This the biggest fight they've had at Madison Square Garden in recent memory. And certainly, it draws comparisons in New York minds with the great night 28 years ago exactly, when Ali and Frazier met for the first time. And the highlights of that one, the fight of the century, as it was called at the time, they come later on. But next up, we go back to Manchester, and it's Crawford-Ashley. This is a very important night for a man who's twice before challenged for a world title and come up short. But he's desperate to get back into the big time. What a record he's had overall, Barry. And reigning again as British Commonwealth and European light heavyweight titles. But the problem is, along the way, Crawford has made a mess of things time and again.
Well, Crawford's had two shots at the world title before. He's fought Michael Nunn, and he's fought for another version of the title, and he defeats me at the moment. However,
Virgil Hill.
He's a guy who's been at times inconsistent and hard to keep his focus. He's a fairly complex sort of a guy. I think he'll admit that himself. But he's a tremendous puncher. He's got great combinations. However, he's 31 years old now, and 34 years old, I should say.
Yeah.
So time is slipping away, and Clinton Woods is elusive, difficult to hit, moved up in weight, and shouldn't be able to have any power to cause trouble. But it's a tough fight for him, I can tell you.
Well, Ashley realises that it is a big test for him, and he's told us during the week, no more undercard fights. I do not want my career to trail off, but if he is to prevent that from happening, this is a fight he must win.
What have you been saying, Henry?
Here you go, gentlemen. Your Pizza Hut Sicilian meal deal.
Shall I do the honours?
No, you want to let the waitress. You might leave me out.
Get a Sicilian pizza with a garlic and herb 1-2 combination and two Pepsis, all for just £9.99. Your place or ours.
I think I can do this, one of these flips, come on.
Leave it, Henry. Forget about that. Oh, my... What?
Three light heavyweight titles on the line in Manchester now, the British, Commonwealth and European crowns. They belong now to Crawford Ashley. But at the age of 34, what is left in the tank for this fellow? And is the man in the other corner good enough to test that out tonight? 26 years of age, Clinton Woods, former Commonwealth super middleweight champion, stepping up and so far promising at light heavyweight. Here's Gary Logan.
And now, five fans from the Bowlers Nightclub in Manchester. This contest is your chief supporting contest of the evening. It is sanctioned by the British Boxing Board of Control, the Commonwealth Boxing Council, and the European Boxing Union. Your presiding Boxing Board of Control official and your Commonwealth Boxing Council official is Simon Block. Your European Boxing Union official is Peter Stuckey from Switzerland. Your judges, all from England, are John Keane, Nicky Van, and Terry O'Connor. Your timekeeper is Barry Pinder from Sheffield, and your referee is star referee Roy Francis from Kent. And now, ladies and gentlemen, live and exclusive on Sky Box Office only, 12 3-minute rounds for the British, Commonwealth and European light heavyweight titles. Introducing to you, in the blue corner, your challenger, wearing these solid white trunks with blue trim, fighting out of Sheffield, Yorkshire, weighing in at 12 stone 6 pounds. This gentleman brings to the ring an impressive record: 22 fights, 21 wins, 11 inside the distance, against only one defeat. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Clinton Woods. opponent in the red corner, your champion, wearing the black trunks. He's fighting out of Leeds, Yorkshire, weighing in at the championship limit of 12 stone 7 pounds. This gentleman brings an impressive record to the ring also. 40 fights, 31 wins, 27 inside the distance, against only 8 defeats and 1 draw. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the British, Commonwealth and European light heavyweight champion, Crawford Ashley. 12 3-minute rounds of boxing.
Look after yourself at all times, the man said. Very, very British touch this, the three championships with three British judges if needed. Well, the Roy Francis, who doesn't vote, he might have to do a bit of counting instead. That's Clinton Woods from Sheffield. Only one loss, and that was at super middleweight to David Starry in Hull, and then he moved up to light heavyweights. So it's, well, in the words of Crawford Ashley's trainer, Bob Padgett, it depends which Crawford turns up. He says, you know how unpredictable he can be. Brilliant sometimes, and just a little lazy on other occasions. But I'll have to drag, I suspect, to get down to this 12 stone 7 division, 175 pounder. But he makes it. It was a bit tight at the weigh-in, apparently. And there was some talk about, well, it might be his last at light heavyweight, but I doubt whether he'd go up to heavyweight. It's not big enough. Cruiserweight, actually, yeah, 13 stone 8. Oh, well, I think the right Ashley's turned up for this one.
Well, Reds, with three titles at stake, I mean, Crawford can't really slip up. I mean, this is everything going in one fell swoop if he doesn't perform. Woods, he's an excellent opponent, Reg. He's not maybe the most fashionable boxer you'll ever see. I wouldn't call him awkward. He's better than awkward, but he's got a kind of unorthodox style. But Ash will have to be his best and keep his concentration going. But he's already drawn blood from his nose, so that's certainly a positive start.
Well, he certainly got over being shell-shocked and knocked over, surprisingly, in London by Ollie Lee Clements in Crawford Ashley, and ordered by the Border Control to take a rest and had to be medically tested and everything after. But he's made a really good comeback since then.
Well, Clinton Woods, Reg, has decided to try and come forward. I got to see, I'm slightly surprised. I thought it would have been a counter-punching campaign in the early stages, but maybe he feels if Ashley's tight at the weight, get some steam out of him as soon as possible. A little bit reckless Woods here in the first round. Ashley can certainly punch, taking some chances.
We've certainly saw Crawford actually in the beginning of his career, Jim, when we were on the road doing these shows, didn't we? Didn't think we'd still be around at 34, and sometimes better than ever.
Always liked him though, Red, you know, always liked the way he went about his business. Not much in the first round, Reg. Maybe shade it towards Ashley. Just more accurate with his punching. Woods trying to come forward, but not, couldn't really call it pressure as yet.
All he got was a bloodied nose in that round, Woods. Oh, there you are. A couple of Cockney lads in the corner there. Former boxer Tony Broome on the outside of the ropes, and Bob Padgett inside.
Yeah, well, that was probably the only burst of punches from Ashley in the first round. He's nursing himself in nice and steady. But you can see the nosebleed already.
How rainy boxed for, actually, for Fitzroy Lodge Club in London, but very much a Sheffield man. That was a nice close-up of the thoughtful-looking champ, isn't it, at the moment? One Lonsdale belts, had two cracks at the World Championship away from home, one in Memphis and the other in State Line, Nevada. You've got to go something to go and win out there against Michael Nunn and Virgil Hill. So, second round.
I know Woods has come up with Edge from super middle, but he does look a bit smaller than Ashley, doesn't he? Ashley looks a lot more powerful.
That's the 12 stone limit, super middleweights. The Ben Eubanks, those guys at that weight, and Steve Collins.
Woods is taking the bull by the horns here. Reggie is taking chances, trying to force Ashley back, trying to set the pace. Don't know if I would advise that or not, don't know.
Ashley can't afford to take this guy lightly, actually, Jim. He's a bit of what they call a nuisance. He comes at you in awkward stance, maybe, but gets away with a lot.
No, as I was saying, I wouldn't call him awkward, because that's not fair. He's unorthodox. But actually, this is slightly different from his normal style. He's very aggressive tonight. He's really up for this fight. And Ashley is a man who likes to intimidate opponents with his power early. Well, I think Woods is showing him that he's not in the slightest intimidated, and I believe him already. Can't ask for any more commitment from Woods Edge, can we?
No, absolutely.
This is good stuff.
Well, that's what you call a challenger, is it?
He doesn't have a lot of power, Edge. He's not a big puncher. But he's forcing Ashley to work, and I think that is probably his main plan.
You whipped that uppercut in there, right above our commentary position there, Ashley.
Ashley's doing the right thing, Reg. He's not reacting. I mean, he could maybe end up losing a round or two just by being outworked. But what's the point? Wasting energy, missing. He's taking his time. He wants to use his power, not waste it. So plenty of time to go, no signs of panic in Ashley's work.
He needs an impressive fight, actually, Ashley, here. If you remember, that French-African, he made a hard work of him, Cedric Barney. Oh, that's better. He's opening up a bit now as Woods comes in.
I remember the Sullivan fight, Reg, that was a split decision, but I thought Ashley won it clearly.
Yeah, I agree.
Know,
so
know why, did I. Why the judge went against him.
Yeah, up in York, wasn't it? I thought it was a terrible verdict to make it split. He had a pretty good round there, Clinton Woods. He did all the work. A little bit of decent countering later in the round coming in from Ashley.
I think a problem he might have, he was breathing with his mouth open. He was breathing with his mouth open towards the end of the round. I think that nosebleed could give him some problems. But I mean, that was a good round, total commitment. But if you're breathing with your mouth opened against a big puncher, then there's always a chance you're going to get some jaw damage, have the jaw broken. So I hope the bleeding stops in that nose. It's far too early to be hindered by that. But a good round from Woods.
See, this is where Woods came back there. Got away with a couple of decent punches there too.
Yep, we saw total commitment from Woods in that round. Good round for him.
Third round coming up. British, Commonwealth and European Championship at stake here.
Decided that he can't beat Ashley on the back foot. I thought, I expected him to be doing it on the back foot. It surprised me. I wonder if it surprised Ashley, but he's quite prepared to come forward.
Doesn't like to be harried too much like that, Ashley.
He's a decent counter-puncher, though. He's got to watch for that, Woods. If he walks in a bit reckless or head held high, he could well get tagged.
I think the danger will come, Reg, as the rounds wear on and the pace slows. Ashley is not reacting too much to these attacks. He's still keeping calm. He's not using up too much power. But if he's tight at the weight, Reg, Woods is doing exactly the right thing. This guy is going for these three titles.
This was some game plan they've come up with. The boxer Andy's called him on for Clinton Woods.
Ashley hanging on, Reg. Who would have thought that in the third round?
Yeah, you'll have to dig a bit deep here.
It's the way he's been forced back, Reg. This is really surprising me. Full credit to Clinton Woods.
Decide the last minute of the third. Well, he held on to the ropes there as well. Just as well he didn't land a blow. I think the referee would have backed him there, actually. He doesn't like that. Unfair use of the ropes.
Well, Reg, I'm surprised, and I think Crawford Ashley is shocked the way Clinton Woods is coming at him.
Yep.
This is really working for him at the moment. Really fired up. He's given Ashley no room to punch, no chance to get leverage into his shots. Perfect tactics, working a treat. You have to remember, Reg, a big punch is not the most important thing. A sound chin is far more important, and I reckon Clinton Woods has that, so this may well work for him.
Well, it's a bit of a shock going on there, I would have thought, for Crawford Ashley. I must say, I agree with Jim. Well, I didn't think Clinton Woods, well, almost had the nerve. He's certainly a brave enough guy, and he's trying to take over early on.
You see, the thing, Reg, it's not half-hearted attacks. He's not toying with the punches. He's putting his heart and soul into these attacks, so he doesn't have to worry about counters. He's forcing Ashley back, and he's really going for it. This has really surprised me. See, he's really nothing half-hearted about what he's doing, putting everything into that. Ashley all over the place here.
There's Palmer collected in that corner with Howard Rainey, the trainer. And there's a rundown on the punches thrown there, but Woods had the edge on it. Round four. The man with the championships and the Lonsdale belts and the reputation is well under fire here.
Ashley, I think, trying to get the jab moving now. Ashley has an excellent jab, but Woods has taken it away from him in the first three rounds. No doubt he'll try to get it working now.
He's picking them slightly better in this round now, Ashley. Paul Dempsey said at the start of the show, he doesn't want to go back to be the supporting player on fight cards. But, you know, he's been through some wars, 41st fight at 34 years of age, Ashley. You're wondering whether that will catch up with him and if it's true that he has to work too hard to get the weight off.
I wonder, Reg, if it's possible he's underestimated Woods, because Woods is the type of fighter, what he's done so far, he could underestimate him. But he is really fired up here. Ashley just getting some punches off a little bit better this round.
Yeah, which just won't give him the room to work, actually, really. It's crowding him the whole time.
Woodsman just not quite as effective in this round. It's when the pace slows that you start to think that actually his power might come into play then, with that little extra split second to get the shots off.
Good competitive championship like this.
Yeah, this is far better than I thought, Legend. Far different from what I expected. Well, Woods finishing strongly, which augurs well for the rest of the round, for the rest of the fight.
Woods following him back to the corner there. I just say, how do you like that? He's got very big support actually from Sheffield, Clinton Woods. Now there he is. The bruises and cuts of battle there are showing, isn't it, on the right hand picture there of Clinton Woods. Let's have a look at this replay now.
Well, that was a tough round. Ashley made his stand in the early part of it. Woods looked as though he was going to become a little bit ragged, but he grit his teeth and just did what he's been doing for the whole fight so far, given everything he's got. He's not thinking about pacing, he's not thinking about the next round, he's only thinking about the round in front of him. And so far it's working well. I believe I've got them dead level at the moment, Reg, but this is a belter.
For the fifth round. And it certainly proved a hard defence by the look of for Crawford Ashley in the three championships. There's confirmation then of Jim's scorecard, as he says, has him level. But just to remind you that three English judges, John Keane, Northampton, Mickey Van Leeds, Terry O'Connor, Birmingham, if we do need the points.
Ashley not looking the force that we've seen him in the past, Reg. He's flagging a little bit. This pressure is getting to him.
His way through all the bruises and blooded face and everything, Woods, doesn't he, Jim? He's one of those throwback old pros, he is.
Yep, and Ashley's the one who really doesn't fancy this pace. He's the one who wants to get the pace drop, take a breather. Woods has shown the commitment again.
But we are wondering at the same time, Jim, whether Woods might punch himself out a little bit if this keeps up.
He's looking stronger at the moment. Ashley is always the one grabbing hold and trying to look for the breather, backing off. This is a real hard battle. Well seen, there's three championships at stake here. See, it's the way Woods puts so much into the attack. He doesn't send the punches in, he takes the punches and he follows the punches in. If they don't land, he's right on top of Ashley, giving him no room to counter. This is perfect tactics. Not always pretty to watch, but exactly the right thing, right on top of Ashley all the time.
There's no way that Ashley can play so matador, is he? This bull of a fellow is coming at him, and he's really got to unload some stiff punches to keep him in check.
And you can see Ashley's mouth wide open, Regis was speaking, gasping big breaths. This pace is getting to him.
And we're only in the fifth round, Jim.
Yep. Whoever come up with this plan for Woods has come up with a good one.
Well, I think we might credit to manager Dennis Hobson and certainly Howard Rainey, who's worked with some pretty good fighters too. He's been around a long time, Bobby Patchett as well. Cockney lad from South London, and see, they're trying to keep that bruising and swelling down over the right eye there.
See, he's breathing through his nose again, Reg. That's good news, because that nosebleed could have given him some problems, but it seems to have cleared up. There he goes, breathing through his nose, so things look a wee bit better for him.
And he seems to be agreeing everything the trainer's saying. It's very good when you're sitting on the stool, Jim, as you well know, but when you get up, it's got to be done. Round six. Ashley, just to bring you up to date, obviously there he is in the black trunks. And Clintonwood, not particularly well known to the fight public at large, as he boxed a super middleweight and lost only one contest of 22. Hasn't got a great record for stoppages, really, but he gets through some of them. I think it's about 11 he's had.
So this is a completely different Clinton Woods there to the one I've seen in the past, Reg.
The one that fought David Starry, he wasn't very good that night, was he?
No, but this way really fired up. Maybe the extra weight agrees with him, Reg.
Yeah, it would seem that way, yeah.
He's standing off now, sending the jabs in. That's not what he wants. He doesn't want to trade jabs with Ashley. Carrying the punches right in and getting on top of him has been working. He doesn't want to stand off and trade. Started bleeding again.
Now, I think he can cope with that all right, Jim, as you say. It does affect the breathing, but if you have to lose blood, it's best through the nose than through cuts around the face.
Actually,
he's trying to whip that
again.
Uppercut, and he's trying to stop Wood in his tracks with that.
Wood standing off a little bit more in this round.
Big right hand, isn't he now, Ashley, quite a bit, showing it a bit too much perhaps, but Wood just keeps storming in.
Ashley's got a lot of things going for him, Reg, but I'll be honest, digging in deep when you've run out of steam is maybe not one of his strong points. I mean, he likes a fight where they can get into control and let the big bombs go. Really feeling the pace here.
Clinton Wood supporters there. Been chanting all the way through. Well, this is where you can see that right hand has been showing that. And then probably the uppercuts have been his best punch. Darby's landed right on the point of the jaw with it, but it's done. And there's Wood flying back again. Talk about teeth gritting stuff, that is, isn't it? Oh,
They'll keep that swelling down a bit. I mean, it's not going to get any better. Well, actually, you know, there overall now is throwing more, well, almost more punches than you see Woodford 297 against 293. It's getting closer. Seventh round. And an extraordinary display actually by the challenger Clinton Woods from Sheffield. Smudged blood on his white trunks there from his own nose.
Well, as every picture tells a story, and that the picture of Ashley sitting slumped in his corner, really gasping for breath at the end of that round, he is really feeling this pace. Yeah, as I said earlier, having a big punch is nice to know, but if you've got true grit, conditioning and a good chin, and that's what Clinton Woods is showing here, that can usually come out on top. Ashley flagging badly here.
Yeah, looking to hold on as well, didn't he? Certainly to stop Woods from working inside. Getting a bit untidy, it says they're both Garth and Pereira, it would seem, but at this time in the early morning anyway, they must be a bit tired hanging around to get in the ring even.
Sometimes you can see Woods' punches are not of the highest quality, but he's pumping them out, hedging, he's taking the initiative, getting into the driving seat.
Always looking to pick that one punch all the time, Ashley. Meanwhile, Woods is pumping out his night's work. But he's taking some in reply, of course.
But it's just everything he's got, Reg, he's putting into this fight. He's really going for these three titles. You really have to commend him for this effort. Ashley again, the one walking away looking for the breather. Woods exerting the pressure. Not always tricky, but this is looking good.
He's really flailing there, Ashley.
Well, as Ashley sat in the corner at the end of the last round, Reg, he looked exhausted, and he's finishing this round in the same state. Wide open all the time, Ashley, trying to draw breath into the lungs here.
Certainly slumps in the school there, Ashley, I must say, when he gets back there, he sits down and thinks, oh, well, thank God there's somewhere to sit. Yeah, Woods had the upper hand there on the punches landed. So Woods on top on this replay, Jim.
Well, Reg, this is the important round. You're halfway through, just over halfway through the fight. Still got five rounds to go. If you can put a dent in the other guy, this is the best time to do it. Break his heart, still with almost half the fight to go. And that's what Woods done. A big attack. Stuck with it, and Ashley really looked exhausted as that round ended. If Woods can pick up the next round at the same type of pace, he can bring this man's heart. Look at him in there, Reg. What does he look like?
So, the eighth round. And the man who came in as a distinct underdog here, Clinton Woods of Sheffield. Just a remarkable performance. Jim Watt's rightly been saying, he's not the most stylish of boxers, but he gets the work done. And Jim's got him a couple of points ahead on his unofficial. On sheer work rate.
Yep,
sheer work rate, desire, will to win, just throwing everything he's got into this. Ashley always the one trying to break the action, trying to slow the action. Well, I'll say it again, Reg, this is a totally different Clinton Woods from the one I've seen in the past. Picked a nice night to blossom, hasn't he?
Absolutely, he's really pumped up for it.
Reg, there's signs that he could force a stoppage here. Ashley's got nothing left. Nothing left. I don't know if he's got weight worries. I don't want to blame it on that, because I don't want to take away from Clinton Woods.
No, exactly.
It's superb.
He's fighting the right type of fight. Hitting on the break there.
Ashley is just going through the motions, Reg. He's got nothing.
Yeah, no. They throw the towel in. Bobby Padgett in the corner threw the towel in, but the referee stopped it anyway. Officially, they shouldn't throw the towel in, actually, believe it or not. In that eighth round, Jim Watt spotted it immediately that he had nothing left. And Bobby Padgett, good compassionate act there from his trainer, actually, and manager, or commercial manager anyway, Tony Breen, made up their mind. They must know that he's dragged to do the weight, and they don't want to see him take further punishment.
And Reg, I'd like to dwell on that for a minute. All the boxing knockers all over the world, or all over the country. There, a corner man seen his man had nothing left but courage, and he picked the time and threw the towel in. We know what we're doing. This is a rough game. It's a dangerous game. But we're here because we love it and we look after our kids. And that's what happened here. But
good.
Look at the commitment from Woods here. First class. All you can ask from a guy. What a night he's picked to bring out the best in himself. Actually, nothing left here. He's been breathing with his mouth wide open for the last two rounds. In goes the towel. He was still on his feet, Reg, but nothing to offer. And look at Clinton Woods, feel for the guy.
Yeah, at least he can walk out under his own steam there, Jim. But what a fantastic win for this fellow who came in, as I say, with not exactly a no-hoper, but certainly a distinct underdog. Not in his own mind, obviously. See, he agreed with that, Roy Francis. He makes the actual decision. It'll be referee stop the contest and not retired.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 1 minute 38 seconds of round 8, referee Roy Francis stops the contest. Ashley in no position to continue. Your winner and new British, Commonwealth and European champion from Sheffield, Clinton Woods.
Big night of boxing already in Manchester. Just to remind you of the highlights. At this point,
champion Crawford Ashley, ladies and gentlemen.
Damaen Kelly, the reigning Commonwealth flyweight champion, has added the British title belt after a points win tonight over Anthony Hanna. Then it was Michael Brodie's turn, and another brilliant display from Brodie, 25 in a row, and he is still the European super bantamweight champion, stopping Salim Medjkoune in the ninth. And as we've just seen, we have a new British, Commonwealth and European light heavyweight champion, and it's Clinton Woods, who's been knocking on the door for a while, and he has beaten Crawford Ashley on an eighth round retirement. So much still to come as we build up to the big event in Madison Square Garden. We'll be back in a moment. Heroic performance tonight from Clinton Woods, the new British Commonwealth and European light heavyweight champion, and he did it the hard way in a grueling affair against Crawford Ashley. Here he is talking to Rob McCaffrey.
Okay, it's not the best you looked a bit here, but it must be the happiest you felt for a while.
Best I've ever felt in my life. I knew I could do it. I've gone through. I've boxed a very strong fighter. I've showed people that I've got the strength for this weight.
Jim Watt was saying it was a different Clinton Woods tonight. What was different about you?
It's been different from the last two fights. I don't feel comfortable going back Woods. I'd rather be a fighter. That's what my tactics were today. It's good to win, wear him down. That's what I've done.
It takes some doing, doesn't it, Barry, in a big title affair like this one, for Clinton Woods to prove to us all that he can back a man like Crawford Ashley up?
Absolutely. Intrepid tactics. And he obviously had made his mind up that this was the way to beat the guy. Keep the pressure on him. Crawford doesn't like being backed up. He's a tremendous puncher, but it's worth the risk taking the fight to him, because maybe it's because he doesn't do the weight too easy. He's a huge guy for the weight, and he doesn't like being put under sustained pressure. And that's what Clinton done, and fair play to him. And obviously his nose is broken because the blood was very dark coming down. Mm. But again, just it shows the amount of courage the guy has. And it was kamikaze tactics, but it worked for him.
Thrilling affair.
He won it in style.
Jules?
Mm, it was definitely a very, very brave fight by Clinton Woods. From the offset, Ashley got his jab going, and he damaged Woods' nose in the very first round. But Woods just refused to be backed up and intimidated. Kept backing Ashley up and wore him down.
Evander Holyfield himself would have been proud of that performance, and Holyfield perhaps starts the favourite tonight in the big one we shall see a little later on. We've consulted an expert to find out how the betting for Holyfield against Lewis has been going. Here he is, John McCrick.
In America, when any event is too close to call, the sportsbooks say to the punters, pick 'em. That means you choose. And that's just what the bookmakers are doing. Unable to separate the fighters, they're asking for 11 to 10 on. That's either Holyfield or Lewis. The draw goes in at 40 to 1. That's running for the bookmakers. But to make real money, you've got to go on the round where one of the fighters is going to win. And look at it here. It's fascinating with the bookmakers. They reckon that for Lewis to win, he's got to do it early. In the early rounds, that's his shortest price. He's got to get Holyfield probably within four rounds. The bookmakers forecast, well, if Holyfield is to win, Lewis's stamina's got to run out. He'll be able to get him later on in the fight. And if you want it on points, well, it's 2-1 Holyfield. And remember, it is in New York, the fight. 2-1 the home guy, and 7-2 to get against a hometown decision. But I remember two things about the fight. First of all, this is what we always think about Holyfield. Fighting Mike Tyson, the ear-biting, the great man there. But I believe, and so many other people do, that Tyson was a washed-up fighter. All that time in jail, he was not the great fighter that we used to know. And if you go back to November 95, and that's what Lennox Lewis should do, in his dressing room before the fight, they should produce the video of Holyfield fighting Riddick Bowe. A two-stone heavier man, just as Lewis is over Holyfield. And Holyfield was absolutely slaughtered in the end. I backed that night, I backed Holyfield, got 11 to 4 against him. A brave fight, a warrior man, as we all know that he is. But in the end, the sheer brute power and strength of Riddick Bowe ground him down, battered him. I believed he would never fight again, Holyfield. He's come back possibly against spent fighters. Tonight, it's going to be one man, Lennox Lewis, and I forecast round 8, exactly the same round as November 1995. Riddick Bowe, Lennox Lewis, much the same kind of fighter. The kind of fighter that Holyfield doesn't like. He'll wear him down, Lewis, take the 25-1, but a really good bet. 11-10 on Lewis, the Union Jack to be flying, Britain to have the first heavyweight champion of the world this century. Watch it with me, we'll all be shouting home, and get some money from those bookies when Lewis wins.
Mr. McCrick will be delighted to hear that they are staying open, working hard all night, taking your money. It's that big a fight. But they're struggling to separate them, as we've heard. Both men 11-10 on for outright victory. Our latest information is that the bulk of the money has been for Lewis. Not just patriotism, they tell us. Unnamed boxing celebrities and journalists have bet large amounts on Lewis. The largest stake reported, £7,000 in cash. And so much attention has been on Lewis that maybe Holyfield could even shorten up. Which reminds me, I must say, of the night when Holyfield beat Tyson first time round, and on the day of the fight, Barry, there was a big betting move in Holyfield's favour. Mm. In fact, the odds halved on the day of that fight.
Yeah.
Do you see that happening today?
Well, I don't know whether it's the right or the appropriate time to talk about it, but we've heard there's some controversy about the gloves. And this is, there is an issue there that...
Just summarise it for now briefly.
Well, I'll tell you what
it
is.
Our latest information.
The information we hear is that Lewis can use raised gloves, which are puncher's gloves, which gives him a distinct advantage. And Holyfield, in his madness, is deciding to wear Everlast gloves, which are a much more cumbersome padded glove. Now, you'll agree with that, Julius. Mm. It's absolutely stupid. It gives him a real start, and it gives him a head start, and gives him a huge, huge advantage. He's such a pulverising puncher in the early rounds that these raised gloves stick on you. And I just cannot fathom
you're calling it madness, but if you've already stated during the week that it's all part of the round three prediction that Holyfield has come out with is all part of a big psychological ploy to try to put Lennox Lewis onto the back foot psychologically. Well, to see it through, he then says to Lewis, you wear your puncher's glove, and the first time you land, I'll deal with that too. How about that?
I'm as confused
and
as
Evander Holyfield has done these things before, hasn't he?
But the first time Lewis lands on him with a solid right hand, it could be all good night. You know?
Because with those gloves,
like Barry says, those gloves are definitely puncher's gloves.
All right, more scientific approach coming now. We've set our own statisticians here at Sky to work on the outcome of the big fight. We programmed some personal details and the career histories of both men into the computer, and this is what happened. Well, I failed my science, so I'm not very good on this. Do you want to go with the computer?
Well, to me, that's all jargon, because I'm just looking at it as there's going to be two big men.
It's not jargon, it's science.
Well, that's what they say. But there's going to be two big men in there throwing big punches. Whether they say about Lennox's stamina is suspect, we will see tonight, because I don't believe that the fight is going to last that long.
You do, so you're... Well, Mensa man over in the corner, you're the computer
expert.
Yeah,
I'm no Mensa man, that's for sure. But
did you feed the computer?
Yeah, I don't know whether I put too much emphasis on the computer. Like Julius, I think a lot of that is codswallop. It's down to the two fighters themselves when they get into the ring, how they shape up mentally, which is very important. But it depends, of course, on what way the first couple of rounds go. That is the important issue.
Perhaps I should just emphasise it is only a little bit of fun. But do you remember back in the 70s they tried the same thing with the Ali Frazier fights? They got those wrong as well, incidentally. And when we come back, we'll show you what really happened when they met for the third and final time. Two of the all-time greats and the thriller in Manila.